call the Joint Appropriations Committee to order. Good afternoon, everybody. We're going to get started by calling roll. Mr. Secretary, will you please call roll?
Representative Duba.
Here.
Fitzgerald. Mullally.
Here.
Mills.
Here.
May.
Here.
Gross.
Here.
Haugard.
Here.
Senator Nezuba.
Absent, excused.
Wick.
Here.
Maher.
Here.
Greenfield.
Here.
Colbeck?
Okay.
Sutton?
Here.
Johnson? Breitling?
Here.
Representative Howard? Senator Hunhoff?
Here.
And Representative Carr?
Here. We have a quorum. All right. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. This afternoon, we are going to hear from BFM, and we're going to get some detail on the budget that was presented to us in December. I think we got a few new slides, probably a bit of an update, and we'll get into that. If you want to join along, this slideshow is available on BFM's website as well as on our LRC website, correct? Mm-hmm. These two new sheets, will we find those on the BFM website?
Mr. Chair, they're actually part of the presentation. We'll just talk about them when we hit those slides specifically.
We're going to get into it. And so I welcome former Senator and now Interim Commissioner Jeff Partridge. Take it over.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I am, yes, Jeff Partridge, Interim Commissioner of the Bureau of Finance and Management. I'm going to drop the word interim for the rest of the session because that's just too hard to say. Going forward, it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be back in this room. Spent a lot of time here, as many of you know, and I will tell you that it is even more important from looking at the BFM side of things as to what you do and the decisions that you make, and the decisions that the legislature makes has great, profound impact on the state of South Dakota. I have a greater respect for it now. Even more now than what I had when I was in your seat. I can tell you that you have an amazing impact on the employees, the processes, and the people of South Dakota. So thank you for your work and what you do, and it is truly an honor to be here. I wanted to share with you that I've learned a little bit since I've started in BFM, more than I knew when I was in appropriations, that there are really a couple main categories to the Bureau of Finance and Management. There's, of course, the budget, which you spend most of your time with and deal with in BFM. But there's also an accounting systems director, that is Colin Keeler. Many of you know Colin, dealing with all of these systems of accounting and the computer system that deals with accounting. It is a computer system that is quite old. It was developed and implemented in 1986. And so that is the budget system that we use today. We also have our director of EMFO. That is basically all of the billing. Senator Nezuba, I was going to talk to him about this. It is, you know, interesting. When he first got on appropriations, he couldn't keep track of who was a commissioner and who was a secretary, trying to figure that out. And essentially what the bureaus do are service agents to the departments, to the secretaries in those departments, and the Bureau of Finance and Management is no different. We work very hard to be a service agency to the departments and to the state government. And likewise, the billings of all of those agencies is something that we manage. Additionally, you might know that they put together the formerly known CAFR, which is now called the ACFR, and that Keith and his team do that, you know, with what they have there. And so then we have a number of other departments as well, you know, with internal controls and different things that we'll go through on Thursday. But I've learned quite a bit that BFM is more than just budget. But that is what we're going to talk about today, is really the budget and who's on that team for budget and budget analysis. Okay? So going through that, oops, sorry. Of course, we've got myself as interim commissioner. Derek Johnson is our state economist. Many of you know Derek, of course, dealing with all things related to the economy. Morgan Griebley. I knew that, actually. Morgan is outstanding, our chief budget analyst, managing all of the budget analysts that are here today to help us. And you'll see them throughout session, of course, as they come and talk to you about different bills and things of that nature. One of those being Haley, who's here, Laura's here, Brandy's here, and of course I mentioned Colin already. And then Matt heads up our Executive Management Finance Office, EMFO, and Matt will be giving the presentation actually on Thursday for BFM. So I'll do a brief intro and then Matt will provide all of the details regarding our budget and present our budget to you. So what we're gonna do today is talk about the economic outlook, the revenues, the FY22 mid-year, and special appropriations, and then, of course, the 2023 expenses. Before we dive into the economic outlook, I want to let you know that we published today the long-term financial plan. Some of you may remember that the financial plan was something put forth and on the road to AAA. Senator Hudhoff was part of that. Behind me, I know there's Senator Tiedemann, also a big part of that, related to getting us to AAA in South Dakota, which is a big deal. And it was a very huge accomplishment for the state of South Dakota to be recognized as such. We put long-term financial planning in place through a Senate bill in 2015, and so we issued that out today related to the long-term financial plan. It's on our website. Please take a look at it. I think it'd be worth perusing. And, of course, I love financial plans. We also did the five-year capital expenditure plan today, going through that. And then we also did our debt management policy, issuing out our entire debt limitation and management policy. That might be interesting to you, Representative May, related to debt management and all the debt that we have in the state of South Dakota. So it's all there. Transparency is the key for the Bureau, and something that we really don't take lightly in terms of wanting to make sure that we are sharing everything with you that we possibly can. My commitment to you during the session this year is to try to get you as much information as we possibly can. And we will work very hard to do that, as you would expect me to do, knowing, you know, what you're looking at and deciding on as we go forward. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Derek Johnson to talk about our economic outlook. He is our state economist and is skilled and adept at that, and I'll turn it over to Derek. Or Morgan, you're going first. Sorry.
I'm going to stand between you and revenues. So I just want to quickly give an overview of our budget process. Most of you are aware of how this looks, but very similar to your LRC fiscal staff, BFM, each analyst has a set group of agencies that they are assigned and they work directly with. So just something to remember that if you see them, we're there for questions that you may have. Please approach them with anything, any questions, anything that you would like us to follow up on. They may not know the answer, but they will certainly make sure that they get the answer. So in August, all agencies submit their budget requests to BFM. In September through October, we are reviewing those requests for assigned agencies, and then we make internal recommendations to the commissioner. In November, we then give a statewide recommendation to the governor and her staff. In December, the governor presents her recommendations to you, the legislature. January through March, budget decisions are finalized by the legislature, which we're currently in. And then April through June, budgets will be loaded, and then year-end spending plans are finalized. So just wanted to give you a quick highlight on that before we dive in.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. Derek Johnson, I'm the economist with the Bureau of Finance and Management. I'll start out by briefly talking about the work that goes into the revenue estimate, and then we'll move on through our actual revenue estimates, the forecasts, and then on to expenses with Morgan. So we, of course, monitor all of the revenue sources throughout the year, the ups and downs, and try to understand what's happening with each of the sources. Try to stay in contact with folks in the industry, with our contacts at the Department of Revenue, with our contacts as part of the Governor's Council of Economic Advisors. And then in addition, we contract with a company called IHS Market to help with some of our modeling and economic forecasting. And for some of our larger revenue sources, such as the sales and use tax, contractors excise tax, and the insurance company tax, we use an econometric model of the national and state economy to estimate those revenue sources. We'll go into that in more detail as we get later into the month and into February, setting those revenues. But with the economy being as it is right now, we wanted to talk about some of the assumptions today and the key factors for our estimate. And before we do that, I'd like to remind you that these are based on a November forecast in advance of the governor's budget recommendation, which was presented December 7th. And so these aren't current up to January. So we'll look at the economic assumptions, some of the economic assumptions used in the governor's recommended budget. First, there's no economic recession included in the state or the national forecast. Second, United States real GDP is forecast to grow 5.5% in 2021 and 4.3% in 2022. And if you recall or if you're aware, U.S. real GDP fell 3.4% in 2020. Third, South Dakota real gross state product is expected to grow 4.4% in 2021 and 2.4% in 2022. South Dakota real gross state product grew actually by 0.1% in 2020. Next, the forecast did include the IIJA, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. The bill doesn't have a substantial effect on the forecast and on our general fund revenues. The peak isn't until 2025, raising GDP about 0.5% at that time.
Car.
And finally, price pressures, inflation is expected to ease next year, and actually this year being 2022, next year at the time that these recommendations were made, and into 2023. And I'm certain that you all are aware that CPIU is nearly 7% year over year as of November and has been high for months. You know, there's some base effect to that, but either way, we expect CPI to start to ease potentially as 2022 progresses and we move into 2023.
Mr. Johnson, we're going to stop for a second. We have some questions. Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So when you're talking about your GDP and the growth, what are you using? Do you use industry norms, or how do you come to that?
Mr. Chair.
Please.
Yeah, the growth forecast that we get is through the company that we contract with. In order for them to come up with that forecast, they're using a variety of different data, industry data, census data, projections, those sorts of things. But these are forecasts for 2021 and 2022.
Any other questions? Representative Duba.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Could you give us a sense of why South Dakota GDP growth forecasts are lower than the national average, both for 21 and 22? Why do you see the difference?
Go ahead.
Sure, Mr. Chair. Sure, yeah. And when you're looking at these forecasts, what you have to take into account is the actuals that occurred in 2020. And so the United States, where the United States fell 3.4, the South Dakota actually grew 0.1%. And so South Dakota weathered the storm and was less impacted. And so less impact means slower growth coming back. Traditionally, the South Dakota economy is less volatile than the national economy. And so those are some of the things that would play into the forecast of it returning.
Follow up. I can understand that for 21. Are you saying that's also in case in point for 2022?
Mr. Chair. Yes, and that is in due in part to the fact that South Dakota did not decline. Their GDP did not decline. And so some of the increase that you're seeing elsewhere is gaining back what had been lost. And so the expectation would be that South Dakota's GDP growth in 2023 would come down to more of a maybe more of a usual increase in real GDP.
Just one more question. Thank you. What do we normally average in a normal year?
Mr. Chair? I've got some U.S. real GDP statistics in front of me. Looking back, starting at 2016, 1.4%, 2.3%, 2.9%, 2.3%. These are real GDP, and so it's adjusted to take out inflation, but that would be, kind of a historically, at least in the past handful or so years, of what growth has been.
For South Dakota?
Those are U.S. numbers.
That's what I thought you said. I guess I was asking you about South Dakota.
Mr. Chair? Representative Duba, I don't have the South Dakota figures in front of me, but I could certainly provide those and
That's
follow
all right.
up with those.
For now. Thank you very much.
Yeah, if you just want to send them over. Sure. Thank you. Representative Haugard.
Yeah, just a quick question in regard to that last line, price pressures to ease next year. Is that based on the presumption that we certainly hope we don't have as awful inflation rate as we did this past year? Is that kind of what leads into a presumption that it might ease next year?
Mr. Chair? Correct, Representative. The forecast is that the growth, the amount that we're growing over the current prices right now, would begin to slow as we move into calendar year 2022, into the second half of 2022.
Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I should have asked this question of Morgan, but I just wanted to comment. In your budget process, you say that BFM gives the statewide recommendations to the governor in November, and then the governor presents her budget address in December. When does appropriations get that?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Representative, are you asking when the legislature receives the governor's budget recommendation?
No. I'm asking when
the requests.
Appropriations gets the requests. Like, you give it to the governor, the statewide recommendation is to the governor in November.
Yep.
When does appropriations get that those recommendations from BFM?
Go Mr. ahead. Chair, the governor is the governor presents her budget address in December, and that is the first time that the legislature is presented the recommendation on behalf of the governor. The day of the budget address, we, BFM, transmits a file to LRC with all of the data within the recommendation. However, LRC receives the requests from the agency by the end of October, so no later than November 31st. Those are the requests and not the recommendation. The recommendation comes specifically from the governor.
There was an additional question. Somebody had their... No? Okay, let's proceed.
Okay, so here are some U.S. indicators in graph form, and these forecasts are based on the calendar year. So not the state fiscal year. The F that you see there stands for forecast, not fiscal. 2021 is listed as a forecast, again, because this is the November forecast, but also because data would be lagged even if it was a current forecast. U.S. real GDP makes back the ground lost in 2020 and 2021 with growth in 22 and 23. The recession obviously had a huge impact on national employment. The forecast calls for employment levels to grow above trend rate into 2023. Builders continue to build new houses at a swift pace. Low interest rates and high demand have pushed that, and the growth has actually been in despite of challenges such as rising costs, supply issues, shortage of workers, things of that nature. The forecast is for new housing starts to slow in 2022 and 2023 off of the 2021 pace. And then inflation is also obviously important for our tax base as prices go up, so does revenue. However, as inflation increases, it also has an effect on consumer confidence. And so what we see is that it's kind of competing effects on the forecast. The forecast calls for still elevated inflation in 2022 before slowing in 2023. And I just want to make a note about inflation. You may see the numbers up there that look like 4.6% in 2021, 3.3% in 2022, and 2.1% in 2023. The headline numbers that you'll see in the news are close to 7%. Those are measured as November 2021 CPI versus November 2020 CPI. These figures that we're looking at here are measuring the average CPI across a year versus the average CPI across the previous year. And so it's an average of the 2 years and the change. Thus, the numbers are less drastic. Now onto the state economy. These forecasts, again, are based on a calendar year, not the state fiscal year, but the calendar year. Employment was less impacted in South Dakota than the rest of the nation. We recovered more quickly, and the forecast includes continued growth in employment through the forecast period. Non-farm income grew 5.3% in 2020 and is projected to grow 5.3% in 2021. Forecast includes growth of 0.6% in 22 before growth of 4.9% in 2023. Housing starts in South Dakota have also been very strong, as is similar to the rest of the country. These are expected to follow a similar trend where we see some cooling in housing starts over the next couple of years, but still good levels of activity, at least historically. Finally, we're anticipating the unemployment rate to remain low in that 2.7% range throughout the forecast. Okay, so switching gears towards what this means for revenues now, I want to start out by looking at what we've been seeing with our sales and use tax revenues. In this chart that I'm bringing up, we passed out copies just so that it was a little bit easier to see for you. We're going to talk a little bit about this, more than a little bit about this chart. We're going to talk about this chart in good depth here. So let's take a close look at sales tax. You guys have probably seen this chart. This is a chart that we really like, and we put this out on our metrics each month. What it does is it shows two fiscal years. So you can go back to fiscal year 21 on the left side of the chart, and then fiscal year 22 is on the right side of the chart. First, I'd like to talk about what blue bars are measuring here to get everyone the right frame of reference. The blue bars represent a year-over-year growth in our sales tax, and so this is comparing actuals to actuals. So if we start on the far left of the graph, we're measuring sales tax collections in July 2020 versus sales tax collections of July 2019. And so that's showing that in July of 2020, sales tax collections were around 10% larger than in July of 2019. The next blue bar represents August of 2020. Sales tax collections in August of 2020 were close to 12% greater than August of 2019, and so on. And then the red line is the running growth year to date in sales tax for that point in time. So starting at the left, the beginning of fiscal year 2021, you can see we start with really strong growth in the first 4 months, all over 10%. And to provide context, and we talked about this at the interim meeting, we would typically categorize 4 to 5% sales tax growth as somewhat normal. In fiscal year 2020, if we backed this chart up and showed 2020, the previous year, we finished just under 5% growth in sales tax. We didn't see declines in our revenues in South Dakota in fiscal year 2020 that maybe some other locations saw. And so we had a typical year of growth in sales and use tax in fiscal year 2020 that we're comparing to.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you. We have a question. Senator Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Do your magic black boxes down at BFM have any way of identifying how much of this growth is inflation growth versus exuberance in the South Dakota economy? Is there any way to separate that?
Go ahead. Mr. Chair. Senator, that would be difficult to try to separate where this growth is coming from. You know, we can look at broad categories of our sales tax collections to identify areas, but as to where the prices are coming from would be difficult. I would remind you that, you know, when we're looking back at this chart back into the fiscal year 2021, inflation would not at that time have been playing very largely into this, because our inflation rate in terms of growth over fiscal year 2020 was very little, and in fact in some months it was reductions in prices. So.
Any other questions? Okay, seeing none, let's keep moving.
Okay, so that 10% growth in early fiscal year 21 was really strong, as it was growth on that normal year of fiscal year 2020. Then you can see it falls a little in November and December, which would line up with some of our COVID statistics at that point in time. And when we revised revenues, when revenues were adopted in February of last year for fiscal year 2021, they were adopted at just over 10% growth for fiscal year over 2020. And if you look at where that red line is in January and February of last year, it was right around that level. It was right around 10%. So the revenues that were adopted were not adopted to fall from the level that they were at. They were adopted at a level to maintain, essentially. And then we close out the fiscal year 2021 with extraordinary growth, as you're all aware. 16.5% in March, 25% in April, over 28% in May, and 19.2% in June. And that type of growth is unprecedented. And you can see we finished fiscal year 2021 at 13.9%. Okay, so now moving to the right side of that black line into FY 2022, the blue bars are now representing growth over fiscal year 2021. So if we look at the July 2021 bar, that blue bar there, that represents 14% growth above July 2020. So it's growth over that first blue bar, which was growth over the previous year. August 2021 is measuring against August 2020, and so on. And we continue to see strong growth in fiscal year 2022 over fiscal year 2021. July grew 14.5%. August and September were both around 7.4%. October 11, November was just over 10, and December was over 21% over the previous December. And that red line again represents year-to-date collections, which are 11.8% higher than fiscal year 2021. And you can look at the bottom right of that graph there. There's a black line for the growth of the governor's revised level at 3.4%. So based on the governor's recommendation, the projection is for that red line to come down to 3.4%. Now, in the 2 months since the governor's budget was finalized, sales tax collections have been above the revised estimate still, particularly in December. We expected growth in December, especially when you consider that December of 2020 there is the shortest bar. It was the weakest month of the year, and so we certainly expected growth. However, we didn't project 21% growth over that blue bar. And this could be due in part to a number of things. I'm sure there are many theories. December collections are the result of November sales, I would remind you. The growth could be the result of some tailwinds from inflation. There's also reason to suspect that supply chain issues resulted in increased Christmas shopping in November, possibly. But looking forward, the projection is that it will be very difficult to continue to grow over the previous year numbers. As we begin to compare to the historic sales tax figures that we saw in the second half of fiscal year 2021, the blue bars will get shorter and likely go negative in some of those spring months. And so as a result, the red line that's at 11.8% currently would move downward closer to that 3.4% number for the governor's revised level. All right. So I'm going to talk about some of the other revenue sources here. This chart shows the legislative adopted estimate on the left and the revised estimates on the right. Last year, the JCA adopted ongoing revenues were $1.833 billion for fiscal year 2022. And the revised fiscal year 2022 budget calls for an increase in current year of ongoing revenue of $129.3 million to $1.962 billion.
Senator Hunoff.
Thank you. Just for clarification, the adopted would be at the end of March,
last year, and the ongoing or the revised would be the governor's budget. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair, that's correct, Senator.
Thank you.
So the projection for sales and use tax is revised up $92.5 million in fiscal year 2022. Lottery revenues continue to be strong. Lottery estimate is revised up $21.7 million. Contractor's excise tax is revised up about $6 million. Year-to-date, contractor's excise tax is up about $2.8 million. Insurance company tax is up revised up $3.3 million. As it relates to unclaimed property, the governor's recommendation is to cap the portion of that that is considered ongoing at $40 million, and any amount beyond that to be considered one-time. And we'll talk about that a little bit more when we put all the one-time funds together. Licenses, permits, and fees is fairly flat, revised up about $0.2 million. Tobacco taxes are revised downward $1.4 million as they are below adopted levels year to date. Other ongoing receipts are revised up $12.4 million. The largest portion of that would be related to investment income and interest of $8.3 million. And the total change is again $129.3 million. This is ongoing revenue, which is revenue that we have a reasonable expectation of continuing to occur. One-time revenue is that revenue that we do not have a reasonable expectation that it would continue beyond the current year. And we'll talk again a little bit about one-time revenue in a couple slides here.
Mr. All right, Chair. We have a question. Senator Hunoff.
Thank you. I know this was one of the members asked the question, I believe, Senator Johnson, if it was inflation or that. And I got to go back to that graph in the sense that, you know, towards the end of the month, just as a provider and trying to get supplies, our prices went up extremely, and so then you turn that around, you charge the customer more, and you couldn't get the products up there. So how much of that, you know, as you're projecting, and we can't sustain those, where inflation is coming in there, because, you know, if you had a product to sell, you couldn't sell it because it wasn't on the shelf, and then those that were, the prices doubled on the things. Just a question if that's analysis, the right thinking process.
Mr. Chair. So, Senator, I think you're saying that the large increase that we saw in December was perhaps fueled somewhat by the inflation of prices. You know, that certainly could be part of it. And inflation, when we're projecting sales tax, is an interesting item to factor in because, as I said, you know, inflation has a tendency to push numbers higher. But as inflation gets too high, it starts to affect consumer confidence, you know, and folks will figure out a way to spend less money as the bills reach higher.
Senator Hunoff.
Just one more. Back to, you don't have a breakdown by month, and I know we get it, and I don't have it in front of me, but I'm looking at that contractor's excise tax. Okay, how many building projects could not be done because they couldn't get the materials? It wasn't there. So, you know, was that up front, that increase in those early, in the fiscal year, early months when you're still able to get some materials and now you're backlogged? And again, the cost of the product is just escalated so much. So I'm just trying to bet on the come, and that's why I'm asking the question. Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, let's keep moving forward.
Okay, moving on to the next slide here. The first three columns are the same as the previous chart, showing the increase of $129.3 million in the current year. And then the two columns furthest to the right are the recommended FY 2023 estimates and the growth over the revised fiscal year 2022 estimate. And based on the large increases in the current year and the previous year, we're not expecting further large growth in our tax base for fiscal year 2023. Overall, the projection is for growth of $13.2 million. Sales tax is projected to grow $5.8 million, which would be approximately 0.5%. Lottery, contractor's excise tax, insurance company tax projected to grow $2.9, $2.6, and $3.6 million, respectively. So then on this slide, we show what this means for additional money available to fund ongoing expenses in fiscal year 2023. On the top line of the table, we bring that $129.3 million estimated for current year revised ongoing revenue growth. The second line is then the projected ongoing revenue growth from fiscal year 2022 to 2023 of $13.2 million. And lastly, there's $15 million in ongoing revenue growth that was left on the bottom line in the currently adopted ongoing budget. You likely all recall that the budget adopted by the legislature last March left $40 million on the bottom line. However, the adopted revenue included $25 million in one-time revenue. And so $15 million of that would be ongoing adopted revenue that's left on the bottom line. And for a visual of that, the budget in brief from last May that was presented, you can find that in the general fund condition statement, page one, to view that $40 million on the bottom line as well as the $25 million that was adopted as one-time revenue. This would leave $157.6 million as the number available to fund ongoing expenses in fiscal year 2023. And then in terms of one-time revenue in the current fiscal year 2022, again, fiscal year 2022, ongoing revenue sources are revised upward $129.3 million. The second line is the one-time revenue that we have available. The legislature adopted $25 million in one-time revenue in fiscal year 2022. The revised estimate is $43.2 million in one-time revenue, which is made up of $28.3 million in one-time sales and use tax due to audit, and $14.9 million in one-time unclaimed property, which is the amount projected above $40 million. And then the third item is the transfer from the budget reserve of just over $28 million. The governor is recommending this amount be transferred from the budget reserve to the general fund. This amount matches the recommendation for the Department of Corrections Rapid City Community Work Center for Women, which is found in Senate Bill 32, which is available online. And then $40 million, again, was left on the bottom line in fiscal year 2022. And so this would be available to spend as well. All told, that is $215.5 million in one-time revenue in fiscal year 2022. Okay, so we'll move on to expenses then.
All right. So as Derek pointed out, we'll switch over gears and talk a little bit more about expenses. So we'll start with first by talking with the fiscal year 2022 or the current year budget. I would like to take a moment first to mention a couple items. So some agencies you've been hearing have some, we've had budget hearings already moving forward. Agencies have referenced one-pagers on a lot of these budget items. They are out on BFM's website. I'll try to point out throughout the remainder of the slides where some of those key items may be so that you can reference those if needed. A lot of this information can also be found on the Special Appropriations and Mid-Year Adjustment section of the Governor's Budget Book. That's pages 16 through 20, that's the large book, or the Governor's Summary Book on pages 41 through 45. You should have received copies of both those books in your legislative mailbox. If you did not, please let us know. We'd be happy to get you a copy. The other item I'd like to just point out, this is going to be a high-level overview. I will be the first one to say I am not the expert in these programs. I'm not the guru behind a lot of the how we got to, I understand how we got to the numbers, but when it comes to the nuts and bolts of the numbers, the agencies themselves may be the correct individuals to answer those questions. So for today, I invite you to ask questions, but I may we may be just taking them down and ensuring that the agencies hit on those during their budget hearings so that you have the correct information in front of you. So this slide in front of you, this is the other slide that we printed out to have for you to have. So this slide is an overview of the FY 2022 recommendation. We'll dive into each of these numbers in the following slide. So this is just a high-level view at this point. So starting at the top of the slide, as Derek mentioned a moment ago, there's $215.5 million in FY 2022 revenue available. This is for ongoing revenue and one-time revenue. Then we are recommending $98.9 million in FY 2022 expense reductions. This is shown as a positive number on the summary sheet because it's increasing the bottom line. Next, we are recommending $33.4 million in FY 2022 expense increases. This number is shown as a negative number because we're going to be decreasing that. We are recommending $9.1 million in FY 2022 transfers. and there are $271.8 million in recommended 2022 emergency special appropriations. As a reminder, each of those will have a separate bill hearing as they move through the legislative process. Lastly, there is $63,000 for the continuous appropriation adjustment for DPS's fire premium refunds per SDCL 1044-9.1. So at this point, I'm going to dive in. I'm going to skip over the 215 number as that's the number that Derek just covered with you in detail. So first, to start with the $98.9 million, if we start off, the first reduction of $49.2 million is for the enhanced 6.2% FMAP rate. So FMAP stands for the Federal Medical Assistance Percentage. This is the percentage that the federal government pays for Medicaid expenses. The amount that the feds pay is based on state per capita income. The state share of Medicaid is currently at 41.41%.
Just a minute. We got a looking for some.
Comparing this morning's notes.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, all right. Just want to stay on task. Thank you.
Okay. So the Family First Act provided a temporary 6.2% increase to the federal share of the FMAP beginning January 1st, 2020, and extending through the last day of the calendar quarter in which the public health emergency declared by the Secretary of HHS ends. This means that the federal government is paying an extra 6.2% to cover increased Medicaid expenses. The public health emergency is slated to expire on January 6, 2022, which means the state will receive the extra 6.2% through March 31, 2022. At this point, we have not heard if that public health emergency will be extended. We'll know more in this month if that would be extended into another quarter. The $49.2 million includes three quarters of general fund savings, which is through our third fiscal quarter, which ends March 31, 2022. This impacts the agencies of DSS, DHS, DVA, DOC, DH, DOH, and DOE. The next item is the reduction of $39.1 million for coding public health and public safety payroll to the Coronavirus Relief Fund. We've had in-depth conversations with this committee about CRF, the Coronavirus Relief Funds. So this is coding payroll from July through December. CRF did expire on December 31st, 2021. We'll be doing some cleanup and utilizing the end of those funds. The next item is an $8.8 million reduction for the state aid revision. This is due to final fall enrollment numbers and property taxes coming in higher than expected. This is a typical annual adjustment. Then we have a decrease of $615,000 due to the lower than projected dual credit enrollments. The next item is a one-time reduction of $574,000 in personal services at SDDC to align their budget with anticipated expenses. The next item is a decrease of $265,000 to align the budget with projected clients for the remainder of FY22 and the drug and DUI court treatment program within UJS. The next is the reduction of $189,000 within the Department of Corrections to align their food services budget with updated inmate counts and meal rates. And lastly, there's a $181,000 reduction due to updated actual full-time equivalent student numbers.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Morgan, I realize that you said you may or may not have the answers, but you may on this front, and if not, please share with somebody else that we'd like to know. When it comes to the state aid revision, you mentioned enrollments and property tax estimates were higher than anticipated. I think you probably mean enrollments were less than anticipated.
Correct.
And
Madam Chair, sorry. Correct. Yes, Senator, the enrollments were lower and the growth was high. The growth in valuations was higher.
Do you know those numbers?
I do not have them in front of me. I'll make sure DOE comes prepared for their budget.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yep.
Morgan?
Yep.
I have a question. You said the food services, that was a reduction of that of 189.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Manager,
and we're
yes,
just flipping it over then because... yesterday we heard they needed an increase of food services at HSC because of the growth in the number of trustees that are projected in Yankton. So, okay, thank you.
Yep. All right, so taking us back to that summary slide, I'm just walking through each of these. We're highlighting the next one, and then we'll break out what actually goes into that specific number. So now we're going to switch over to the decreases. So this is spending the dollars. So I just want to take a step and let you know that the first line item is all of the amounts in the prior year general bill, which was introduced as Senate Bill 60 this year. You also refer to this as a supplemental bill. So to start, there's a expenditure increase of $25.3 million. This funding increase for the changes in Medicaid and CHIP eligibles in FY22 as a condition of the additional 6.2% enhanced FMAP. DSS discussed this during their budget hearing yesterday. The enhanced FMAP includes a maintenance of effort that the states must provide continuous coverage for Medicaid and CHIP during the public health emergency, which is slated to end on January 16th. The next is a $3.3 million expense for the Victim Services Grant Supplement. This funding is to make up for the shortfall in the federal VOCA, or Victims of Crime Act grants, that have resulted from federal cuts to the program. These grants are used to provide direct services to victims of violent crimes, including sexual assault, domestic abuse, and child maltreatment. The next item is a $1 million increase for correctional health care, and that's based on updated patient count and the increase in medical supplies. Next is a $763,000 expense for certain medical supplies within the home and community-based programs. The Medicaid state plan included these in their services in FY2022. This amount is based on actual utilization. There's a $680,000 increase. This funding will allow for wildland fire to support firefighting efforts. This equipment will allow for wildland fire to more safely and efficiently fight fires. The next item is $675,000 for drill rigs, water trucks for geological survey. This is a replacement of the drill rig and water tanks for Daner's geological survey program. The current rig has been used to drill close to 2,000 test holes for 94 different projects over the year. One of the current drill rigs is 37 years old and is rapidly wearing down. Breakdowns currently happen due to engine and mechanical failure, and the rig can no longer reach required depths, so is unable to meet certain project needs. The next on your list is an increase for the developmental disabilities eligibles and utilization. This will align the budget with anticipated expenses as DHS has seen developmental disability eligibles come back onto the system. The next is a various statewide utility increase. Amounts are based off the previous year's actuals and projections in various utility costs. Next are the IT system and updates. These are updates to update and replace various IT systems within the Office of the Attorney General. This funding will provide the Technical Services Unit with a phone analytics data system, update the Criminal Justice Directory, and provide a new data system for the Medicaid Fraud Unit.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And again, I realize that you aren't with corrections, but I would like to go back to that line and ask if you have further narrative on that, because last week when corrections was in, they talked about the number of prisoners within the system having decreased over the past couple of years. It hasn't been as high as previously anticipated. We talked about some reasons for that. You're saying that the patient count is higher, and I'm curious as to what the narrative says there.
Madam Chair?
Go ahead.
Senator, the increase is based on updated patient count. I don't know if it was an increase, but I can certainly follow up and ensure that DOC provides you those numbers.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
So we'll continue to the next slide, which is a continuation of the $33.4 million. There's $209,000 for the Black Hills State University Ellsworth Air Force Base contract. This will pay for startup costs for BHSU to offer on-installation courses at Ellsworth Air Force Base for active military spouses and children, and civil employees at Ellsworth. There's an increase for $149,000, almost $150,000 for the crime scene response vehicle. This vehicle would be for used by agents within the Attorney General's office to investigate crime scenes and inclement weather and provide agents a place to gather, organize, and plan the processing of crime scene in a safe manner. The next item is approximately $84,000 due to the change in legislator salary and the increase in the per diem rate. And lastly, there is a $31,000 increase for the Office of the State Auditor operating expenses. These are used to cover a new contract system and cover increases in copier rent.
Madam Chair.
Representative Duba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to hearken back to the legislative salary and per diem.
Yep.
You know, I'm aware that our salaries went up slightly, but I thought our per diem remained flat.
Madam Chair. So the per diem, let me make sure I grab the right one. The legislative per diem that salaries that legislators received during session increased from $151 to $155 on October 1st, 2021. It's set by SDCL 242.
All right, thank you very much.
You're
I appreciate
welcome.
That.
Just a follow up, is that when you do your adjustments, what's that little group that you do the per diems for the state employees and whatever that increase is, and that impacts what we get for a per diem, and that's done on an annual basis? I don't recall the name of the group. Or what is that?
Madam Chair, Board of Finance.
Yes.
Reviews those.
Yeah, right. And isn't that where that adjustment is made for the legislator for the per diem? No?
I'm looking at a friend. I don't believe so.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
It's set in law of how it's reviewed, and I believe I have the statute, but I don't have this. Yep. Okay, if there's no more questions on that, I'm gonna bring us back to the summary slide. The next item is our expenditure transfers. These will also be in Senate Bill 60. We're recommending $9.1 million in this area. So to start, the first is the transfer of $5 million from the general fund to the court security fund within UJS. This will be used to update and enhance security in courthouses across the state by providing grants to counties. These grants will require a 25% match from the counties. The second item on the list is a $4.1 million transfer from the general fund to the state IT modernization fund within BIT. This will be used to replace and remediate existing applications which are at risk due to outdated technology, loss of vendor support, limited ability of staff with knowledge to support, and the need of enhanced security. Bringing us back to the summary slide, I'll now jump into the largest number on this part of the section. For the $271.8 million in emergency special appropriations, I do want to take a time just to reiterate that these will each have a bill hearing. When we get into the slides, we've actually linked the bill that each one is at. So if you go out to our website, or if you go out to, I believe, probably your board papers, you'd be able to click on that link and it would jump you directly to the appropriate bill. So to start, there's an emergency special appropriation for workforce housing infrastructure for $150 million. That'll be Senate Bill 53. These dollars will be matched by local communities and developers to ensure that everyone works together in this partnership, a third from developers, a third from municipalities, and a third from state funds. This investment will free up South Dakota's tight housing market and open more opportunities for those that may want to move to the state. The next is a $30 million emergency special appropriation for the Dakota State University Cyber Program expansion. This will be Senate Bill 54. These funds will enhance and expand cyber program offerings at Dakota State University and launch the Governor's Cyber Academy. As you've heard from Dakota State University last week, this funding will significantly advance the university's applied research capabilities and provide the foundation for a new industry in the state. The next item is a $28 million emergency special appropriation for the Rapid City Community Work Center for Women. That'll be Senate Bill 32. This funding will allow for the Department of Corrections to construct a 208-bed community work center for women in Rapid City. The Department of Corrections presented on this project last week and expressed their concerns with the overcrowded women's community center here in Pier. The next emergency special is a $9.9 million expansion to the Custer State Park, which will be House Bill 1048. The proposed campground will be located about 1 mile south of the State Game Lodge campground near the airport off Wild Loop Road. It would consist of approximately 175 electrical sites with gravel pads and paved roads, 4 modern comfort stations, and other amenities such as playgrounds, picnic areas, and access to trails. The expansion plan would increase overnight capacity of non-equestrian camping by 52%, adding 175 campsites. The increased capacity would provide an additional 20,000 camping units a year and generate an estimated $500,000 of new revenue annually. The next item on the list is for the Cultural Heritage Center renovation. This emergency special will be House Bill 1047. It is $8.9 million. The funding would be used to support a full renovation of the iconic Cultural Heritage Center in Pier. The state will appropriate $8.9 in one-time funding to support the total renovation cost of close to $20 million. The remainder of the renovation costs will be completed with maintenance and repair funds, as well as privately raised dollars. This building was built in 1989. It is time to modernize the facility as there are current structural concerns that need to be addressed.
Madam Chair.
Oh, Senator Nisba.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I know that when we had the Board of Administration here a year ago, we were asking them for an audit of our campus, and we were asking for a 5-year plan of which buildings we were going to expand. I don't remember seeing that as part of our ongoing plan, and I don't recall actually seeing that plan. Is there one? And how does this fit into that overall plan, or is this just a request that came up because we seem to have a lot of one-time money that's available at the moment?
You know, I'm going to suggest, Senator, that we wait till BOA comes in and you ask those questions, because they're just presenting us the information, and I think that way you can answer the questions and have somebody there who's knowledgeable to give you your responses.
And thank you, Madam Chair, and I have no intent to put you on the spot there at all, but just something for our committee to remember and keep in mind.
Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me just clarify on the Custer State Park. You said we're spending $9.8 million, and you said it would bring in $500,000 in revenue?
Yes. Madam Chair, it is an estimated $500,000 per year.
Per year. So
the investment would be up front, and then it would bring.
I understand, but I just wanted to clarify the numbers.
Correct. One time $9.9 million and $500,000 annually in new revenue.
Madam Chair.
Representative Gross.
Thank you. On the Cultural Heritage Center renovation, you mentioned this is part of the cost. The rest would come from a maintenance and repair fund. I'm familiar with the HEF fund and how that works with our Regental system. Tell me a little bit about the maintenance and repair
Madam
resources
Chair.
For this.
I'm going to hit high level on it, and I'll let the Department of Education and possibly BOA dive a little bit deeper into how this would look. Certain areas within this project are maintenance and repair fund eligible. It is a state building. There are some structural concerns to the foundation and various FDA or ADA compliance items that would be able to be covered with M&R funds.
Thank you. Follow up. I'm not so concerned about the project itself, but, you know, a better understanding of the maintenance repair fund.
Madam Chair, Representative Gross, the maintenance and repair funds would be BOA state general funds as part of the state maintenance and repair budget held within Bureau of Administration.
Okay, thank you. That's what I'm looking for.
All right. So the next item I'm going to continue with is the Lake Area Tech Advanced Manufacturing Lab Space. This will be House Bill 1031. This will be $7.5 million in one-time funding to support the new archway complex on the campus of Lake Area Technical College in Watertown. The commitment from the state of South Dakota will be matched by $7.5 million in private and local contributions from Lake Area Tech. The next is $6.5 million for the Richmond Dam replacement. This will be Senate Bill 52. Richmond Lake Dam is a state-owned dam in Brown County. It holds over 3.7 billion gallons of water and is only a few miles from Aberdeen. The dam was built in 1936 and is 52 feet high and 1,550 feet long. Richmond Dam is a high-hazard dam that would cause significant damage and potential loss of life downstream if it were to break. A 2008 breach study showed the dam would cause millions of dollars in damage, and because it is only 5 miles from the city of Aberdeen, there would be limited time to evacuate in a catastrophic event. Richmond Dam is also a major recreation area with a state GF&P campground, recreation area, and permanent housing on the lake. The next item for flood repair projects, which will be Senate Bill 67. This will be $5.6 million. This funding is to replace the spillway structures at Newell Lake and Lake Alvin. These spillway structures were significantly damaged by flooding in 2019. Lake Alvin is a 105-acre impoundment located in Lincoln County, and Newell Lake is a 154-acre impoundment located in Butte County. Start with that. The next is a $5 million emergency special. House Bill 1032 will be the Mitchell Tech Agriculture and Diesel Power Space. This is one-time funding for a new technical laboratory and shop space in support of the agricultural and diesel power programs on the campus of Mitchell Technical College. The commitment from the state of South Dakota will be matched with $5 million in local and private industry funding from Mitchell Tech College. Okay, the next slide now breaks out. We have three slides, so just bear with me on this a little bit. The next slide starts with the Southeast Tech Health Sciences Simulation Equipment. This will be Senate Bill 61. $4.5 million in one-time funding to support the simulation equipment and technology in the new Health Sciences Clinical Simulation Center at Southeast Technical College in Sioux Falls. The new center at STC will address tremendous workforce demands in the healthcare field and house simulation equipment and learning laboratories to support the CNA, LPN, RN, sonography, and surgical technologist programs. House Bill 1016 will be the annual emergency and disaster fund. This was a $2.9 million emergency special. As emergencies and disasters occur in South Dakota, the Emergency and Disaster Fund is used to pay for costs associated with cleanup, repairs, rebuilding infrastructure, as well as maintaining safety during the disasters. Because of the difficulty of predicting natural disasters, DPS spends this fund negative and then asks to backfill the fund and bring the balance to zero. House Bill 1049 will be for a Rapid City Firearms Range Complex, which will be $2.5 million. This includes funding to support the construction of a new firearm range near Rapid City. The range will be constructed on 400 acres of rolling topography. Solitude and natural beauty offer the perfect site for sporting enthusiasts within minutes from Rapid City. Organized in two separate areas, north and south, the complex offers a variety of options for all levels of hunters and recreational shooters for law enforcement training. The next is a $2 million emergency special appropriation, Senate Bill 51, for volunteer fire service assistance. This funding will support firefighter training as well as recruitment and retention efforts for fire departments across the state. This includes the purchase of two mobile burn trailers and equipment, assistance with the construction of a fire tower and burn room for use by fire departments across the state, and a statewide recruitment and retention campaign. The next item.
Yep. Senator Johnson.
Thank you. Could you go back to the Emergency Disaster Fund, House Bill 1016, the 2.9? Do you know what that was last year, what our backfill expense was last year?
Mr. Chair, Representative, we did not backfill last year. The last backfilled was in 2022 legislative session at a cost of $9.9
million.
2020. Yes, 2020 legislative session.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
$9.9 million was the last. I apologize.
Okay.
I'll continue then with the Reemployment Assistance System Upgrade, Senate Bill 31 at $1.5 million. This funding will be used to update the Reemployment Assistance Enterprise System into modern computer technology. The current system is based on legacy mainframe technology from the 1980s. Modernizing the system will allow manual, time-intensive processes like benefit payments to be completed more quickly and smoothly with fewer follow-ups.
Mr. Chair.
We have a question. Representative Duba.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a question on this last reemployment system upgrade. I thought that we had approved a similar total last year in the Department of Labor's budget for a system upgrade. I remember they came specifically to us and talked about the need for system upgrades. So what is different about this?
Mr. Chair.
Please.
At this time, I'm blanking on that. So I'll have the Department of Labor be able to prepare what they spent, what was yet last year's versus this year's.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay.
The next item is the Extraordinary Litigation Fund, House Bill 1019, which is $1.5 million. This funding will cover the costs associated with litigation against the state, which are not eligible for the People Fund. The next item is the Wildland Fire Suppression Fund, House Bill 1017, a little over $1 million for that. The Fire Suppression Fund is used to pay for the state share of firefighting costs in South Dakota. Because of the difficulty in predicting the number and the cost of fires, Wildland Fire spends the fund negative and then requests the backfill to backfill the fund to bring to zero. The recommended amount is the negative cash balance plus outstanding receivables as of June 30th, 2021. The next item is the Rural Recruitment Assistance Programs, or House Bill 1030. This is $1 million. This is the amount to pay for the state portion of 12 provider professionals currently practicing in rural areas. It also includes the amount to pay for the state's portion of 57 health professionals finishing their three-year commitment. On this slide, the last item is $1 million for the Wagner National Guard Readiness Center addition, which will be Senate Bill 48. The Wagner Readiness Center will add approximately close to 7,000 square feet to the current facility while updating the HVAC and electrical systems. The new addition significantly reduces the shortfall of administration, classroom, latrine, and shower space available to the unit stationed in Wagner. The project includes fire protection improvements and upgrades to the computer wiring throughout the building to support the network requirements of the various systems used to train the soldiers stationed at the facility. And the third slide starts with the state radio towers, which will be Senate Bill 34 for $750,000. This funding will help improve first responder coverage in two different areas of our state. A portion is for a new tower in Redfield, as this area currently does not have a tower, but is served by a booster that sits on top of the Spink County Courthouse. And a portion will go towards the replacement of the tower and the equipment in White River as well. The next emergency special is House Bill 1013 for the Capitol Lake Master Plan for $500,000. This funding, along with with federal ARPA dollars, will address several long-term issues at the Capitol Lake. This project will include capping the existing well, pumping water from the Missouri River into Capitol Lake, dredging Capitol Creek and Capitol Lake, provide for the opportunity to redesign the existing memorial area to better serve all parties, and to provide an opportunity for irrigation of public properties. The next item is for the Sioux Falls National Guard Readiness Center, which is Senate Bill 41 for $500,000. The Sioux Falls National Guard Readiness Center is almost 48,000 square foot building, which is designed for a minimum life of 50 years and meets LEED silver standards. This building will provide an additional space for administration and training to meet all state and federal missions. The total estimated cost is $21.7 million. Last year, $500,000 in general funds and $15 million in federal funds were approved. This adds an additional $500,000 in additional general funds towards the project. The next is for the tax refunds for the elderly and disabled, which is House Bill 1014 for $450,000. From last year, the sales or property tax refund program is a method. This bill is similar from last year. It's an annual bill. The sales or property tax refund program is a method of returning to senior and disabled citizens some of the dollars they pay each year in sales and property taxes. The program has been in effect since 1974, and during that period has returned over $35 million to South Dakotans. And lastly, the National Guard Cold Storage Replacement, or Senate Bill 49, is for $225,000. The construction of the cold storage building at the Range Road Readiness Center in Rapid City will protect equipment from the extreme cold and snow, as well as hot conditions, extending the life of the specialized equipment to ensure readiness of soldiers. This storage will also provide greater security for these weapon systems, which are costly to replace.
All right. Good place for some questions. Representative Gross.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The cold storage one, didn't we just do one of those within the last couple of years? And is this another one or an addition to what we did?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
You are correct. This is an addition.
Additional site, in addition to the one we did?
An additional site.
Okay, thank you.
I'll make sure DOM clarifies where we've done them.
Okay, any other questions? We're going to keep moving. We've got scheduled till 4:30.
All right, so this slide now shows the recap of the summary, showing the bottom line at $0. So at this point, we're going to switch gears to the ongoing budget. This is for fiscal year 2023 expenses. So first, I'll recap. As this slide shows, that as Derek presented earlier, there is $157.6 million in ongoing revenue projected for FY 2023. So this next slide, to best explain this, we broke this out into different categories. And like prior, I'll go into each with greater detail. To start with, the categories we have are the cost for 6% inflation for education providers and state employees. Then we'll move into mandatory increases, then discretionary changes, and finally the continuous appropriation. So first we'll dive into the 6% inflation.
We have a question, Representative Mullally.
Well, this number 157.6 has been coming up, and in our budget brief this morning it was 157.3. So I'm trying to figure out where the $300,000 coming from. I could be wrong, but.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
If I were to speculate on the difference in the number, would probably just be without the continuous appropriation change of $200,000, just the changes that would be included in the General Appropriations Act. So.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I'll continue. Thank you. First, we'll discuss the 6% inflationary increase for education providers and state employees. Over two-thirds of the governor's recommended budget is to fund 6% inflationary increase. So diving into that, the breakout of the $104.3 million, the first is the cost for 6% inflation for the state aid to K-12 education, and that's $42.6 million. This will bring the teacher salary to $55,756 from last year's of $52,600. This will be a little over a $3,000 increase. DOE will provide further data during their budget hearing, but also every year there is our annual levy bill, and that has a separate bill hearing, which is Senate Bill 59 this year. The next is the discretionary inflation, which is located in various agencies, and this total is $32.2 million. The next is close to $28 million for an across-the-board 6% increase for state employees. And lastly, $1.5 million is a 6% increase for the per-student allocation formula for the instructor salary support and the instructor salary support budget within the technical colleges.
Question, Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On that technical college formula, is the Southeast Tech College, has that been corrected on the formula for their pay raises for their teachers? Do you know?
Mr. Chair, I am not aware of the updates that the Board of Technical Education was potentially making to the distribution, but I'll have them be prepared to discuss during their budget hearing.
Just while we're on the slide, the salary policy. Last week we had the Board of Regents in, and one of the things that kept coming up was the 6% across the board, but they said that didn't fund, you know, all of their staff. So they were short at every campus X amount because it didn't fund everybody to the 6%, and they were looking for additional dollars to do that. Can you walk me through why some of those would have been excluded from this salary policy, or what was the decision-making process there?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
The 6% is all on all Board of Regent employees, state employees.
Okay. There's some other comments here. Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think the question, though, is, yes, we understand that it affects their salary policy. However, some of those positions are reliant on tuition dollars and state subsidies, and so it leaves them with the decision as to increasing tuition or seeking to raise the dollars elsewhere. And obviously they said it'd be a welcome addition to their budget if we were able to provide additional dollars to alleviate the pressure put on the students or perhaps other donors.
Mr. Chair, that is correct, that the Board of Regents does have general and other funds, and some of those positions are funded through other funds, which would then be tuition dollars.
So they're no longer considered a state employee then, if they're under other fund?
Mr. Chair, no. We have many agencies that fund positions with federal and other funds, general, federal, and other. When we calculate salary policy, but this is solely general funds. If you look at our budget book, we'll actually show the amount that is general, federal, and other for the increase. We simply give the authority to them. It would be up to whether it's a board, whether it's a commission, whether it's the Board of Regents, to those other funds to look within their revenues.
Senator?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think maybe between you folks and the Board of Regents, you can give us a illustration as to the relationship between the different employee categories and who would be funded largely or entirely with state funds and who would be a mix of state local or state tuition and federal funds.
Mr. Chair, we can follow up with that breakout.
Well, I think.
Thank you.
And it's already been, I don't want to belabor too much, but I think the challenge is I'm a professor, I'm getting paid with general funds, but then next door, for whatever reason, he's getting paid with some other funds, I'm going to get a 6% bump and he's not. Or they're going to have to find the other funds to do that as part of this policy.
Mr. Chair, when we look at the budget, when we create the budget, we look at all budgeted FTEs within state government. It is up to the discretion of those entities of how that is within the executive branch. We follow a certain area, but once it gets to the constitutionals or the Board of Regents, even LRC themselves could decide a different distribution of that pot of funding.
Okay. Mr. Chair.
Go ahead, Mr. Johnson.
If I could provide a couple comments, and this is certainly an area where other agencies have brought to our attention, it's really a difference between budget authority and cash, right? And so when we're looking at statewide salary policy, an agency will have general funds, federal fund expenditure authority, and other fund expenditure authority, and we'll increase each of those budgets by 6%. Now, from a cash standpoint, what the Board of Regents is saying is they would like the cash. You know, they either have to raise tuition or find a way to not fund 6% for some employees. So that's really what we're talking about here. So
thank you. Representative Gross.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Follow up on the same thing, and Mr. Johnson's explanation there helped considerably. Are those employees in different various divisions, and a lot of minority university that are paid through other funds, are they on the state medical and benefits plans, though? or are those funded through other funds as well?
Mr. Chair, certainly those employees are on the state's plan. As to whether those benefits are paid with general funds or other funds, you know, it varies by agency. But just as an example, the Department of Transportation and their 1,000 FTE are almost entirely funded with other funds. And so when their salaries are increased by 6%, that comes as a cost to the other funds that are paying for those positions, namely, you know, the highway fund in most cases. So,
follow up, if I may. The reason I ask is, when we run into a parallel situation with benefits, when we look at increases in benefit funding to for insurance funding and that sort of thing, whereas there will need to be other authority to come up with additional money from the other sources.
Mr. Chair, that's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? All right, we'll keep moving.
All right, so now the next area we're gonna hit into is the mandatory increases for $48.8 million. To break this out, the first item is $18.1 million for changes in eligibles, utilization, and costs within DSS, DHS, and DOC. Items included here include services such as more developmentally disabled persons eligible for home and community-based services with the Department of Human Services, increases in subsidized adoptions and guardianships within the Department of Social Services, and changes in patient and juvenile placements within the Department of Corrections, to name a few. The next cost is $13.9 million for the federal medical assistance percentage, or FMAP rate. As we discussed during the one-time changes, FMAP is the share of state Medicaid benefit costs paid by the federal government. This is calculated based on a three-year average of state per capita personal income compared to the national average. To receive an increase in the FMAP, a state must experience a decline in its share of U.S. average per capita income. However, because the formula relies on a three-year average, it doesn't necessarily capture recent trends. So the last couple of years, the state share has been decreasing. However, this year, the state share increased from 41.41 to 42.77. This is not necessarily good news for the budget, but it is good news economically, as it means our per capita income is growing more rapidly than the national average in South Dakota. The next item is mandatory inflation for $6.5 million. There's mandatory inflation in the Department of Social Services. These are increases that we are mandated to pay at various rates, and typically these are rates set by the federal government. The next item for $4.8 million is the state aid to K-12. This dollar amount is for the expansion and the rebase portion. You did see earlier the amount for the 6%. So of this, there is actually a reduction included in this. So there's $1.5 million reduction for the increase of the state aid to general fund expansion. So expansion is figured based on the projection for enrollment and change in local effort, but not inflating the teacher salaries. The 6% part comes with inflating the teacher salary. So this takes into consideration the student enrollment and the growth in valuations. The other part for this is $6.3 million for the special education rebase for each of the disability levels as required by 1337.35.2. This is a rebase year for state aid to special ed. The next item is the maintenance and repair budget. There are maintenance and repair budgets in the Board of Regents, the Bureau of Administration, the Technical Colleges, and the Department of Military. The M&R budgets help to add value and extend the useful life of state-owned buildings. This year, we recommend $2.4 million increase in funding. For BOR, BOA, and DOM, this will maintain a 1.75% of their replacement value. For the Technical Colleges, this will bring them up to 1.75% with shared costs between the state and Technical Colleges. The next item is a little over $1 million for the utility budgets within several agencies. We are recommending an increase based off the previous year's actuals and projections in various utility costs. There are some pay changes in addition to what was presented in the 6% slide. These are the UJS, Justice and Circuit Judge salaries for little over $500,000. This is the second year of the 6% increase in the Justice and Circuit Judge salaries as a result of Senate Bill 139 from last session. This is a 6% increase in addition to the 6% across the board increase recommended by the governor. The other pay increase are for the legislative salaries. This increase is coming at a cost of $95,000. Based on the legislative salary increase from $12,851 to $13,957. Statute says that the legislator salary is one-fifth the median household income. And lastly, there are some various increases and decreases that total close to $1.5 million for mandatory increases to state government, and those will all be covered within their budget hearings. Next, we'll move to discretionary changes for $4.2 million. This is a breakdown of those items. First, within the Department of Health, there is $2.2 million recommended for the EMS telehealth and the Bright Start expansion program. The EMS telehealth would pay for telehealth services between hospital medical professionals and emergency medicine providers in the field to improve efficiencies in patient assessment, treatment, and transportation to definite care centers. Connecting physicians and nursing staff with EMS personnel will ensure patients receive the most appropriate treatment and transport to the most appropriate care setting. The Bright Start expansion is $1.2 million. The amount would allow DOH to expand the Bright Start program statewide. Bright Start is a home visiting program where registered nurses meet with at-risk families during pregnancy and until their child turns 2 or 3 years old. The nurses provide prenatal, maternal, infant, and toddler health assessments, health and safety education, parent support, assistance in setting and reaching life goals, developmental screening, and links with community resources.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And this goes, obviously this question will be directed to the Department of Health, but I'd like to hear more about that. And this goes back 22 years. The very first time that I ever put out, the very first time I was running, I got some help with a piece, and it said, Brock Greenfield supports the Bright Start program. And I thought, I'd better find out a little bit more about what that is if I'm going to put out a mailing that says I support it. And so I've learned a little bit about it, but I was of the understanding that it is statewide. And so if we could get a better grasp as to how it's going to be expanded, that would be very helpful. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, we'll be sure DOH comes prepared.
We've had human services and social services. I know. All right. Let's keep going.
The next item for the Department of Education is the tourism promotion tax distribution for $846,000. This funding has a corresponding decrease in other fund expenditure authority to eliminate the transfer of the tourism promotion tax funds from the Department of Tourism to the Department of Education. Both the Department of Tourism and the Department of Education will speak on this during their budget hearing. The next item is the Department of Labor and Regulation for their adult education and literacy rebase for $495,000. This is a base budget realignment and it is needed to allow providers to keep up with increasing costs. Providers have seen increased costs across the board, and AEL teacher salary is significantly lower than the target teacher salary according to the state aid formula. The base budget for adult education and literacy providers was last adjusted in 2015. For the Board of Regents, NSU e-learning is for $491,000. This program offers courses to schools statewide that do not have teaching capacity for various courses, especially in rural South Dakota. The NSU e-learning program has grown to 1,187 enrollments in FY16 to 2,964 enrollments in FY21, an increase of 149%. In that time, they have not increased their administrative FTE, therefore are looking. SDSD Harrisburg contract for a reduction of $150,000 is also included in this line. The School for the Deaf had a contract with the Harrisburg School District for $300,000 for a bilingual program. The School for the Deaf has not spent this funding since FY18, which was the last year of the contract. There's $10,000 for the Attorney General Medicaid fraud system. This is recommending a Medicaid fraud system to allow a single software solution to identify and resolve cases of potential fraud in the state. The Medicaid Fraud Unit is currently utilizing an Excel document to track cases so that this system will help with tracking and reporting of those cases. And then the last item, there's various personnel increases and decreases for a total of $313,905 in various agencies, including BOR, Attorney General's Office, BFM, School and Public Lands, and DOR. This also reflects decreases within the Department of Human Services. So going back, this is now the recap of our ongoing FY 2023 recommended expense summary. And the last slide that we have to present to you is a quick snapshot of the bottom line for both FY 22, which we covered first, and then FY 23, which we just recapped. And we have one last slide for you with Interim Commissioner Partridge presenting. Do you want here? I'll just let you.
We'll get a couple more years out of it.
I'll use a 5-gallon bucket. That'll work. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioner Jeff Partridge, BFM. I just wanted to kind of wrap up and finish where we started today real quick before we get into targeted tax and fee reductions with the team. You heard from Morgan and Derek, and they are just absolutely awesome related to knowing the budget and knowing what's going on with all the details that go on. So thank you, Morgan and Derek, for doing that. If I could have just folks stand real quick so you can just see them, in case you don't know who they are, Colin Keeler is our director of really systems. You know Colin. He'll help you at any turn, especially related to the accounting systems that we have. Keith Singer runs our ACFR. That's the financial reporting that has all the information in it, especially all the, you know, revenue, expenses, debt, everything, the consolidated financial reporting system. Keith runs that, and we're very appreciative of Keith's work and what he does there. Matt Flett. Matt is EMFO, the Executive Management Finance Officer. Again, all the billings. So over the years, we've talked about what's a commissioner and what's a secretary. And, you know, we have all the billings that go out and manage all the billings. Matt's team does that. Very, very great detailed work on all the billings. And then those who work for Morgan, really appreciative of Laura. Brandy, is Brandy here? Yep. And Haley. You guys stand up. Come on. So just a great team. I also want to point out the help that we get from the Department of Revenue. Obviously, setting revenue is a big deal. Jim Twilliger is here to help us out. If you don't know Jim, Jim's very, very helpful with everything. And Jim turns 29 again today. So happy birthday, Jim.
Happy birthday.
So you heard the state of the state, and we've talked about unprecedented times and that the state of the state is in the strongest position ever. The unprecedented times that we have, of course, call for an unbelievable amount of federal money that we're going to take a conservative leadership approach on. In addition to that, we have the revenue that comes in, the additional revenue with our state doing extremely well with sales and use tax, contractors excise tax, bank, lotto, and the rest. It's unprecedented related to the fact that we are doing strong in the face of adversity, and that speaks a lot to what the governor talked about today. So her approach and her recommendation as we continue to look at this and be quick on our feet as to what's going on and what's happening is to take that conservative approach and look at tax cuts. So the revenue that's come in for, you know, November, December, and potentially January, we don't know yet, but it's been really quite extraordinary. And so you have talked about this, I know. A number of you have proposed different things over the years related to tax cuts. How can we do it? What can we do? What's possible? And so the tax cuts that she proposed today are, number one, eliminating the domestic corporate filing fee. Domestic means in-state. Foreign means out-of-state. Doesn't necessarily mean international, right? But domestic is in-state corporate filing fees. If you want to move your company to South Dakota, you want to start a company in South Dakota, you want to start an LLC, you want to incorporate, that filing fee is now going to be zero. Okay? Yeah. That about $2 million, just under, ongoing. Okay?
One second. So for all those listening at home that have businesses, we're talking about starting next year, or right now, if we get a statement, are we paying the annual report fee, et cetera?
Mr. Chair, thank you for the car. Thank you for
When are we talking about it? It's going to take effect.
Thank you. This will be a bill, and the bill will run through the process just like normal. So should it be a normal bill, it'll be effective July 1st.
Okay.
You could, of course, put an emergency clause on it if you wanted to. So that would be up to the legislature.
Okay.
Okay.
We had one other question, Representative Duba.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think you might have answered it. You said it's a total of $2 million that we would lose annually?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, just under.
Okay.
Another question, Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioner, just a real quick question about a gentleman that was in South Dakota that's moving his business to Rapid City. He said that when he moves his business in here and he's moving in the equipment, that if it's less than 7 years old and it's electronic, big equipment, he gets charged the sales tax on the cost of that equipment. Is that something that maybe you could look into that might be another one of those open South Dakota things that might help businesses decide more to move here? Because he's got, it's millions of dollars worth of equipment that he's moving in, and you heard about it in the governor's speech, I think, today. But he did say that he was going to be charged a sales tax on that equipment when he moved it.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yeah, Mr. Twilliger will go through that use tax when he does his DOR presentation.
Thank you.
All right. A couple more questions. Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So the corporate filing, is it the annual filing fee or just the initial fee for incorporating in South Dakota?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let's go to bullet point number two, the eliminate annual report fees. So the first one is a domestic corporate filing fee. The second one is an annual report fee, nearly $3 million.
Thank you. I'm sorry I didn't look ahead. I apologize.
You'll be fine. No. So that is that looking at basically saying, you know, not only will you be able to, you know, have a domestic corporation filing fee of zero, our annual fee, you know, ongoing, will be, you know, reduced to zero as well. So, I mean, that is really the encouragement, of course, is that you would continue to file your annual fee, annual report, which you have to with being an LLC or corporation or whatever. So, yep.
I'm going to go to Representative Haugard. Nope. Senator Sutton.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. How much is that domestic corporate fee? Is it determined by the size of the corporation? How's that determined?
Yeah, the domestic corporate filing fee, we'll get all those details to you with the Secretary of State's presentation so that you can see exactly what that is in terms of just that filing fee to start a corporation. I don't believe it's related to the size or revenue or things of that nature. It's starting an organization like an LLC or a corporation, okay, filing within the Secretary of State. And then every year there's an annual report that goes along with that.
Okay.
Okay. Go ahead.
As you know, the governor also recommended that you look at eliminating fees for concealed carry permits, enhanced permit, and gold card permit. Not sure why we have the gold card anymore.
Wisconsin.
Okay. I knew there was an answer. So basically, there are three permits that all add up to about $200,000. And so that is looking to eliminate the all of the fees. I think this was reduced last year. Maybe there was a bill for it last year related to reduction or elimination over the course of time. But one of the things would be, you know, protecting the Second Amendment, exercising your Second Amendment rights, does now not have a cost you know, for any type of permit or fee in the state of South Dakota. We think that people will continue to get the enhanced permit, potentially the gold card for individual states, or the ability to carry firearms across state lines. There'll be a continuation for receiving that or getting the acquiring the permit, but there will not be a cost with that associated with that anymore.
Questions? Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Relative to the fees on permits, I'm curious if anybody at the table can remind me. We've addressed this to some extent. I'm curious if there's an impact to the local level, the local unit of government, the counties. And if so, is it half and half or?
Mr. Chair. It's my understanding that half of the enhanced permit goes to the local and local county sheriff, right? Sheriff's office. So our plan is to look at all of those fees and work with the local entities to try to figure out a way to make them whole.
Thank you.
Other questions? Senator Johnson.
So this is a good example where there is a fee for the permit, but there are also costs associated with the permit, like fingerprinting, background check. Those will continue. Is that correct?
Governor said they don't.
I thought she said that they would pay for the FBI check.
Yeah, she said background check costs going away. I wrote it down.
Commissioner Partridge.
Mr. Chair, answered by committee members, I believe.
How about, sir, everybody can hear that's listening.
So, thank you. Again, I think what we're going to do is be able to have a very, very detailed part of that bill. Right now, the goal is to get, you know, your Second Amendment rights in South Dakota are no longer carry a cost to have those permits. The details about the county, the sheriff, the actual fees and that kind of thing, we will have as part of the Secretary's of State presentation.
So thank you.
That'll make that presentation a little interesting this year.
Okay. Any other questions? I want to thank Commissioner Partridge and the staff of BFM and Secretary Terwilliger for joining us today.
I do have a question.
Oh, too late. Okay, Representative Mullally.
How much is the bingo tax?
Thank you. About $30,000 between taxes and fees.
Any other questions?
We expect you to be a proponent on that.
All right. Thank you again for the presentation. We look forward to the constant communication to get additional detail as we go.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. I'm going to open up for any public testimony. Any public testimony? Come on down.
Greetings, committee. Brian Burge from Beersford, South Dakota. So have a tree business and really going well, had a great year. Along these notes for the tax cuts, South Dakota law has a large history of having fees that are associated with the cost of administration of the services rendered. Department of Weights and Measures has by law that half the fee of certifying a component is covered with it. Something like this doesn't affect us too much. The $150 a year I pay in an annual report fee is commensurate with the time it takes the departments to manage reports. The $20,000 in sales tax I have to collect from my customers and transmit back to the state, the unemployment insurance, the fuel tax, those are the numbers that actually matter. So if we do have a year where we have a large excess income, and we're starting to see this trend consistently. Now with COVID is off. Why don't we consider looking at those numbers that have only one significant digit behind them? Why are we 4.5% sales tax? Why have these certain numbers? Those are the numbers that are true tax policy. These are just symbolic gestures for a campaign finance here. Thank you.
Mr. Birch, thank you, and make sure you signed in. Thank you very much. Any other public testimony today? All right. Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I have a motion by Senator Colbeck, seconded by Senator Wick. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. We are adjourned. I'll ask the committee members to stay.